given today, the Sunday, third Sunday of the Pentecost, Sunday when the object of the Feast of the Sacred Heart. We'll be here again in Wisconsin here, in Frederick. And the epistle for this Sunday within the octave of the Sacred Heart, the third Sunday after Pentecost, is taken from the first epistle of Peter, chapter 5. Dearly beloved, be ye humbled under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in the time of visitation. Cast in all your care upon him, for he hath care of you. Be sober and watch, because your adversary the devil is a roaring lion, goeth about seeking whomsoever he may devour. Whom resist ye strong in faith, knowing that the same affliction befalls your brethren who are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us into his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a little, will himself perfect you and confirm you and establish you. To him be glory and empire forever and ever. Amen. And the Gospel, according to St. Luke, chapter 15. At that time, the publicans and the sinners drew near unto Jesus to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spoke to them this parable, saying, What man is there of you that hath 100 sheep? And if he shall lose one of them, doth he not leave the 99 in the desert, and go after that which was lost, until he find it? And when he hath found it, lay it upon his shoulders, rejoicing. And coming home, called together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, Rejoice with me, because I have found my sheep that was lost. I say to you that even so there shall be joy in heaven upon one sinner that doth penance, more than upon 99 just who need not penance. For what woman having 10 groats, if she lose one groat, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently until she find it? And when she hath found it, call it together her friends and neighbors, saying, Rejoice with me, because I have found the groat which I had lost. So I say to you, there should be joy before the angels of God upon one sinner doing penance. Those are the words of today's Holy Gospel. Some of those commandments. A few considerations on this during the sacred octave of the Sacred Heart of our Lord Jesus Christ. It was chosen, I think, the feast to be a few days ago because of this ancient Sunday, this third Sunday after Pentecost. We consider this battle, the battle of the Sacred Heart. And St. Peter says it in his epistle, that be sober and watch. That we would read every night at Compline, we sing these words from St. Peter the Apostle. Fratres, sobrius, sotte, vigilate, that we sing every night at the beginning of the office of Compline, before we go to bed. Be sober and watch, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, goeth about seeking whomsoever he may devour. Whom resist ye strong in faith, knowing that the same affliction befalls your brethren who are in the world. St. Anthony of the Desert, he had a case, the great St. Anthony, where we mentioned frequently, but St. Anthony was once walking through the desert. He used to fight the devil in hand-to-hand combat. And he, in fact, is such a great father of the desert that it's from St. Anthony that we call the priest father. He had a great combat against the devil with such a great love and knowledge of God that he would speak to others about God and they would simply call him Abba, 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 Father. And from St. Anthony and the others who would follow him, we have the custom of calling the priest Father. St. Anthony himself was an Abba, but not actually an ordained priest. But St. Anthony, the Abba, he fought against the devil. And St. Anthony, one day he was walking and a man came to him and said, I have received every blessing. I have had every prayer ever answered, Anthony. I have had a most blessed life. And I came to you to receive a blessing. And Anthony said to him, you've had everything, every prayer was ever all answered, everything you've always received what you wanted, I always have. And then Anthony became, faith became as white as a sheet. And he became filled with terror. And he turned and he ran from the man with full speed. And his disciples were with him, and when they saw Anthony's running, I should probably run too. And so they ran after Anthony. And when they found Anthony, Anthony was terrified, shaking and shivering. And he said, why are you shivering? Because that man, he said every prayer he ever said was answered. He said his life was wonderful and blessed.
he never experienced a trial, God must be very angry with him. And I don't want to be around when God shows up. And therefore he ran. This is the man who fought hand-to-hand combat with the devil. And what does St. Peter say? St. Peter, the great apostle, the St. Peter who knows about combat because he denied Christ 3 times. And he had to walk out of prison after he was newly made pope. And he had to be put into prison because he was made the new follower of Christ. And he died crucified upside down. And every day of his life, he shed tears because he had offended our Lord. And he fought a battle. And so what does he say? Brethren, be sober and watch, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, goeth about seeking whomsoever he may devour. Whom resist ye, strong in faith, knowing the same affliction befalls your brethren who are in the world. And if this affliction does not fall, then they're not the brethren. If you haven't run into a battle, if you haven't tripped and fallen down, if you haven't been assaulted by the devil, if you haven't had difficulties, then you're not my brethren. And remember, our Lord Jesus Christ and his Father say the same thing. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, he has come to save the sinners and not the just. He's come to deal with those that have difficulties, not those that don't have difficulties. And today we're in the consideration of the octave of the Sacred Heart, and a consideration of the heart of our Lord Jesus Christ in battle. Because oftentimes we know this beauty of the most Sacred Heart, that the Sacred Heart forgives us our sins. And the Sacred Heart is filled with great love. But what is this heart in battle? And the Fathers tell us, and some great Cistercian monks on the early, about 800 years ago in the Middle Ages, say, to understand the heart of Jesus in battle, we go to Absalom. And Absalom, remember the real Absalom, he was the son of David, and he actually was wicked. So obviously the wickedness of Absalom does not apply. But what happened to Absalom on his last day, when Absalom tried to take over the kingship, he tried to rule, he actually drove David away, but then he began to lose. And the soldiers came to capture Absalom, and David said on the last day of battle, and this is the day that applies to our Lord Jesus Christ. David said, and David represents God the Father, David said, go and get Absalom, but do not kill Absalom. Save Absalom, my son. Don't kill Absalom. And Absalom fled, and he fled on his horse. And Absalom was very handsome, he was very strong, and very much like Samson, he had very long hair. And so he was riding away on his horse, fleeing from the army of Joab, who was led by David. And as he was riding through the woods, his hair got caught in branches. And his horse went on, and he fell off of his horse, and he hung in the branches above the ground. His sword fell out of his hand, and he hung helpless from the tree. Joab then gathered round him with all the soldiers, and they mocked him. This is the great Absalom, who was just a short time ago, he's king. Now he hangs from a tree by his hair. His glory was in his hair, and his glory is the handsomeness, like a new Samson. But now look at him, he's hanging from the tree. And then Joab commanded the soldiers, and he said, kill him, kill Absalom. But the soldiers responded to Joab and said, Joab, we heard David speak. For he spoke in a most loud voice, and we can all hear. And he said, preserve Absalom, save Absalom, do not kill Absalom, my son. Therefore, we will not obey you. And Joab was extremely angry. The general Joab, the head of the army of the Jews, the head of David's army, he then went and grabbed a spear from one of the soldiers, and he pierced the heart of Absalom. And Absalom was so strong that he remained in the fullness of his strength with a spear in his heart. And then Joab became more angry, and he grabbed the second spear from another soldier, and he pierced the heart of Absalom a second time. But he was still so strong that he panted with the fullness of strength of his breath with 2 spears in his heart. Then Absalom grabbed a third spear from another soldier, and he pierced the heart of Absalom a third time, and Absalom was still strong. And he breathed with 3 spears in his heart. And then finally, he died. And therefore, the Fathers tell us, now Absalom, of course, the real Absalom, he was an evil man. And he died justly for his sins. But on that day, he showed forth the power of the heart of Jesus Christ. And where is the strength of our church? And where is the strength of our battle with Christ? For there are three great spears. And I can't remember the other symbols of these sacred spears. The Joab put three spears in the heart of Absalom. And they are the three attacks of the devil. The attack of the world, the flesh, and the devil. Every single attack he put into the heart of Absalom. And it's the final, also it's the place of the final battle. The fathers tell us this is the place of the final battle. Where Absalom hangs from the tree. And one day Christ hangs from a tree. Absalom hangs from the tree. He has no sword. It is dropped from his hand. He cannot fight. He cannot run. His feet cannot touch the ground. He is completely helpless. And God made sure in his final battle that his hands were also tied, for they were nailed to the cross, so he could not grab a sword and could not fight with a sword. His feet were also nailed so that he could not run, either in battle or to flee. And yet Christ fought. And here he is teaching the warrior how to fight. We even speak in the time in real battle that it is the heart of the soldier, it is the heart of the warrior that matters in combat. There are many men have many muscles, and yet they don't win, and they don't last the whole fight. But in our fight, where it is the heart that wins the day, and Christ fought his final battle upon the cross without using his hands and without using his feet, he fought only with his heart. And his heart defeated the enemies of God. Then we will consider the heart as it is in battle. Because the heart of Jesus Christ forgives those that are sorrowful. The heart of Jesus Christ washes away sin. But what does the heart do to Satan? And what does the heart do to those that do not repent? This heart is most powerful. And we see also the wisdom of Satan, of Lucifer, that when our Lord Jesus Christ was dead on the cross, he was still afraid of him. Because Christ dead still fights. Christ dead is still dangerous. And so therefore, he inspired Longinus, the wicked soldier, to take a spear and pierce the heart of Christ after his death. And when the heart of Christ was pierced, what happened? Out came blood and water. And in that, from that water came the grace of the sacraments. From that water, from the grace that converts souls, it comes from outside, from the heart of our Lord Jesus Christ, and it comes only in battle. Now, we are in a time in Holy Mother Church's battle right now, where the mystical body of Christ, the body of Christ is truly crucified right now. The hands of the priests are no longer blessing. They are tied. They are no longer excommunicating the enemies of God. They are no longer blessing the friends of God. They are tied and nailed to the cross and able to move. The feet are no longer carrying the gospel. The feet are designed to carry the gospel of truth to every place, but the feet are nailed to the cross. And the feet also are above the ground. They are not standing upon the earth. That is, Christ does not rule in any place. He cannot claim any ground of the earth as his right now. The ground has been taken by the enemy. And what is about to happen? Remember that the man that hangs on the cross at 33 years old, during those 3 hours, he is a soldier. He is a warrior. And he is not going to battle except to win, except to defeat his enemy. And he goes to defeat his enemy, and he makes it very clear to his apostles before he goes to battle. Confidite, ego vici mundum. He says to his apostles Holy Thursday night, have confidence. Because I have already conquered the world. Satan is already vanquished. Why? Because I have decided to fight him this night. I have decided to fight him tomorrow on Good Friday. And when I decide to fight, it's victory. And whomever I decide to fight, he is defeated. Because the heart of Jesus Christ, the greatest warrior that has ever fought, the greatest heart that has ever gone to battle, cannot ever be defeated. And he shows the power of his heart by making sure that when he hangs upon the cross, he wins completely and solely with his heart. Now we are supposed to be alter Christus. The priest is supposed to be another Christ. And all of us are supposed to be the members of Christ. And we must recognize that in our church, the true church founded by God himself, only the heart wins. The heart, the faith that is in our minds, if it doesn't trickle down in the heart, it dies. It's dead. It is no good. the faith that is in our mind must go down into the heart. And it is the heart that carries the faith. It is the heart that carries the truth into the real world. And it is the heart that defeats the enemies of God. And so there is a test that he gives to us from time to time. Can you have confidence and believe in the power of my faith, in the power of my holy church, in the power of my cross, when your hands are tied, when your feet are tied, when you are lifted up above the earth, when it seems as though there is no hope, when Joab is going around and mocking our Lord Jesus Christ? And who is Joab? Joab was the general of the army of God. He represents the modern popes. He represents the modern bishops. These are the representatives of God, directly disobeying God, using their power to disobey their king, disobey their God, disobey their master. And Joab was not killed by David. David was so upset that Absalom was killed, yet he did not kill David. He did not kill Joab. When Abishai when had killed Saul, David killed him instantly. But when he was mocked by the friends of Saul, when he was mocked, he did not kill. And so David did not kill Joab. And Joab did not repent of his sin. But what happened? Joab killed Absalom with the three spears in direct disobedience to David. And so likewise, who is the one destroying the church right now? It is the Pope. Paul VI was the one who took a spear and pierced it in the hand and the heart of our Lord Jesus Christ's church. And then John Paul II grabbed a spear and pierced it. And Pope Benedict grabbed a spear and pierced it. And these modern popes have taken a spear and they have pierced the heart of Christ. And it is the popes, it is the heads of the army of God. The Joab was the head of the army of God. In direct disobedience to God, he pierced. He listened to the devil rather than to God. And what happened to the good soldiers? The good soldiers said, "We will not obey your wicked command." So likewise in our holy church today, as the Pope pulls out a spear to pierce the heart of Christ, we cannot obey his wicked commands. We cannot participate in the act of taking a spear. Joab said, "I'm the general of the army," and he was the general of the army. "You take a spear and pierce the heart of Absalom." And they said, "No, for as we heard David say, don't do it." And so likewise, when we are commanded by our superiors to do that which is wicked, we recognize they are superiors. But no, we heard God say, "Thou shalt not kill." We heard God say, "Thou shalt not preach heresy." We heard God say, "Thou shalt not do anything that is directly immoral," and so on. And we will not obey wicked commands. What happens? The Pope pulls out the spear. The king pulls out the spear. The heads of the church pull out the spear. And also the heads of government pull out the spear. And they pierce the heart of Christ. They pierce his heart. And what is happening in this piercing of the heart? The same thing that happened 2,000 years ago. They are being defeated. For he pants with full strength. Joab could not imagine. He had killed so many in battle. He pierced the heart right next to it with a spear. And yet he was still the fullness of his strength. And the second spear, and still the fullness of his strength. And the third spear, and still the fullness of his strength. And Christ demands this of us. We must have the fullness of our strength. That is the faith in our hearts. And let the devil attack. Let the enemies attack. But we will not budge. We will not turn against our master. We will continue to know, love, and serve him as the world continues to reject him. We won't change. And in this, we defeat Satan. And to chase Satan right now has the church in the ropes. This is not the first time our church has been in the ropes. And Satan is afraid. Because he knows that the church, the mystical body of Christ, must also have a heart. And that the heart will defeat him. And these are the 10 just men. Remember when the God said, "I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah." He said, "I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah." When he said that, Abraham said, "If there are 100 just men, will you save it? What if there are 10 just men? I will save." And so right now, America is deserving of great punishment. We deserve a great punishment because of our sins. We deserve the turmoil that is with us right now, and much worse. But if there are 10 just men, 10 men that deeply know, love, and serve God and have a faith, then our punishment can be delayed. Our punishment can be made light. It can even be removed if there are 10 just men. And how do we fight? We must make sure that we become saints. We have to make sure that the faith is deep in my mind, deep in my heart, and motivates my actions. That the love of God, the love of my neighbor, the true love of my neighbor is that which moves me to act. That I love God more than myself, and my neighbor more than myself. I love the faith more than myself. And if this love is there, the heart is strong. And let the spears come. Let the world make its attack. Let the flesh make its attack. Let the devil make his attacks. And they shall not defeat this heart. And furthermore, not only did not defeat it, but by the spear passing through the heart of our Lord Jesus Christ, what happened? Out came the blood and water. That is when he pulled out his victory. And this is what has happened time and time again. What did St. Michael tell Joan of Arc? You are going to have victory. And he spoke to the Catholic priests and the Catholic bishops that condemned her to death and burnt her at the stake. And they said, these Catholic priests and Catholic bishops, they said to Joan, your voice has said you will have victory. How are you going to have victory? Where is your victory? You are captured by us. You're about to be burned at the stake. And if you're not burned at the stake, you remain in prison. Where is your victory? How can you have victory? And she says, my martyrdom. They're supposed to know that. They're Catholic priests. They're Catholic bishops. And they were the ones that martyred her. And they're the ones that made her into a saint. And so likewise, Joab, the one who was commanded by God, he is the one who disobeyed. Now, what about the conclusion? Here we must remember, the heart of Jesus Christ has infinite love. And the heart of Jesus Christ does forgive. But the heart of Jesus Christ only forgives those who are sorrowful. When David was old, about to die, he called his son Solomon. He said, Solomon, you will be the king. The head of the army is Joab. He killed Abner, who was a true head of the army, an honest and just man. And then Joab wanted his spot. And Joab, in the middle of the field, when no one was looking, he stabbed Abner and killed him. But I let Joab live, and I did not punish him for his murder of Abner. And he disobeyed me, and he killed Absalom, my son, and I did not punish him. I forgave him. Do not thou forgive him. I was easy on Joab. You will not be easy on him. And this is my wish, that when I die and you become king, your first act of king is to kill Joab. I forgave him. You do not forgive him. And I command you upon my death to kill Joab. David had not forgotten. Joab was left to go into the heart of our Lord Jesus. I said, let the cockle grow. Let the weeds grow until the harvest. Does that mean he forgot about the weeds? Does that mean they will not suffer? Does that mean they shall not be judged? Absolutely not. For the heart of Jesus Christ, when it has wrath, it is infinitely more angry than the heart of the devil. It crushes more permanently and more seriously than the heart of the devil. Because why does he do this? Because he who loves the sheep, what must he do to those that are destroying the sheep, to those that are unrepentant of the destruction of the sheep? He will have a great and vicious anger towards them. And when they do not repent, they shall be smashed. And we must remember this as part of the teaching of our Holy Church and of the teaching of the natural religion that we all know, that God will reward the just with happiness. But he will also reward the unjust. He will reward them with eternal punishment, and it shall be most harsh. Now, how did Joab die? Joab realized that he was about to die, and he ran into the temple. He ran into the church. And just like in the New Testament, we have a law that a man who goes in the church, he cannot plant in the church. He has sanctuary. He ran into the temple of God. And the soldiers came to Solomon and said, Solomon, what are we to do? Joab ran into the temple. We can't kill anyone in the temple. What are we supposed to do? And Solomon said, go into the temple and kill him in the temple. And so they went into the temple, and they slew him in the temple. And Joab did not escape the wrath of God. And so it is with the wicked men of today, whether it be Fauci and Hillary and all these wicked ones in the world today, or whether it be Cardinal McCarrick, or whether it be Cardinal Ratzinger, or whether it be the wicked cardinals that created the situation in our church today, the other wicked ones, the hair of Cardinal Ratzinger, with the wicked teaching in which he is destroying our Holy Church. If these men do not repent, they shall meet the heart of Christ, and it shall crush them, it shall destroy them. For our Lord Jesus Christ has infinite love, but he also has an infinite justice, and his heart shall not be defeated. Those who are sorrowful and repent and are sorry for their sins, he will take care of them. He will give them forgiveness. And those who do not, he shall crush. We must remember that the victory is ours. And how much of the victory? Complete and total victory. And as our St. Peter says, resist the devil, strong faith. And remember, all of your brethren in the world must experience some suffering. And then St. Peter says these words. He says, but God, the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a little, will himself perfect you and confirm you and establish you. He'll let us suffer a little, not a lot, not too much. He'll let us suffer a little, and then he shall establish us, and then he shall give us glory. And our Lord Jesus and St. Paul said, I have run the race, fought the fight, and for me is the crown of glory, not only for me, but for all of those that love his coming. And so our duty is to have our hearts in love with the coming of our Lord. And this is what we must do in our present time. And we had our Lord praise the Lord of the harvest. The Lord of the harvest prays our Lord said, pray to the Lord of the harvest and send laborers into the harvest. We'll pray for laborers into our harvest who have the heart of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we must take on his heart inside of us, the heart of a warrior who goes as a lamb to slaughter. But let his hands be tied, let his feet be tied, let him be nailed to a cross. But the heart shall not be defeated if we know and love and serve deeply our Lord Jesus Christ and our God in our hearts. Blessed God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.